Hello everybody, I am Zach Peterson. Welcome back to my channel. And today we're gonna be looking at a viewer question all about how to set up isolated grounds in a PCB, specifically in a PCB with 8 layers and a Raspberry Pi CM4. Now, working with isolated grounds is not the most common type of system unless you have a DC-DC converter or you have an isolated interface such as Ethernet. However, if you do have that type of system, you need to set up the ground connections correctly. And that's exactly what we're going to look at in this video. So we're gonna hop onto the whiteboard. We're gonna look at how to set up those grounds and how to connect them back together using Y-type capacitors. And then we're gonna look at some examples inside of Altium Designer. Let's go ahead and get started. So before we get started, let's go ahead and take a look at that viewer question. Mode Hamza Anwar writes, "Hi Zach, this is Hamza from India. I am designing an 8-layer PCB which has power and signal isolator, Raspberry Pi CM4, PCIe, and Ethernet. I have 2 solid reference ground planes, but I am pretty confused in assigning them to a specific ground net, either PGND or SGND, and PCIe is on SGND, whereas Ethernet is connected across a magnetic transformer. Now here he mentions that he is using a Y-type capacitor for connecting these grounds, and he is thinking of assigning SGND for both reference planes with PCIe so that he can get a solid reference plane, whereas pouring PGND copper pour on the top and bottom, but his enclosure would then be connected to SGND. So there's a lot going on here in terms of grounding and using these 2 different planes and whether they should be assigned to the same net or different nets." So there are a couple of things going on here in this question. First of all, he references 2 different ground nets, one of them being PGND, and then the other one being SGND. Now, when I hear this in a question, and when I hear about the use of a Y-type capacitor, it normally makes me think of one type of design, which is a design that uses an isolated DC-DC converter. Now, typically with an isolated DC-DC converter, PGND would of course be your primary side ground, and then SGND would be your secondary side ground. Now, in this type of design with, like, for example, a Raspberry Pi CM4, the secondary side ground would be the one supporting all of the digital signals and supporting the Raspberry Pi itself. And so it would then also be called the signal ground, or very simply just GND, for example. So any of these naming schemes are appropriate. Of course, he used SGND in his question. Now, the confusion for me comes from the fact that a DC-DC converter was not mentioned at all in the question. So whether or not a DC-DC converter is present will really determine how you set up the grounding in this type of system. So let's take a look at an example layout, and we can see some ways that we might set up these different ground regions in this design. So let's just assume for a moment that we have a DC-DC converter in this design, and we want to then figure out where are we going to put all of our different grounds and how do we link them together. Well, in this case, what I would do is I would just set up a dedicated region for the ground for our DC-DC converter section. So all of our stuff with our DC-DC converter basically exists in this area. Now, of course, depending on the size of your system, maybe it spans, you know, all the way across like this. I'm not sure on the board size in this example, but the idea still holds. You basically want to have one section that is set up for your DC-DC converter circuitry, and then this could be your PGND. Now, what is our SGND? Well, our SGND is now basically our signal ground, and it's going to be everything over here to the right. So this is where our Raspberry Pi sits. We're going to have our CM4 module here, and then we're going to have all of our other digital stuff in this part of the PCB. Now, the standard application for a Y-type capacitor is to then link these 2 sides of our design, and we would connect the Y-type capacitor across the primary ground and the secondary ground. Now, of course, if we're using an isolated DC-DC converter, we would then have, for example, a transformer here. And this transformer is, of course, needed to enforce the galvanic isolation between PGND and SGND. So this transformer is going to determine how large this Y-type capacitor needs to be. Typically, this Y-type capacitor is going to be something on the range of like 2.2 nanofarads. So why 2.2 nanofarads? Well, it's not that it has to be this specific value. Really what matters is that the value of this capacitance is larger than the winding-to-winding capacitance in your transformer. And this is going to ensure that any high-frequency noise currents on the secondary side have a low impedance path back through the Y-type capacitor to the primary side, rather than flowing back through the transformer. The whole point here is to control those noise currents so that they don't create radiated emissions from the secondary side ground. Now, this question also referenced something to do with Ethernet. Now, if you have Ethernet, for example, and maybe it's coming in right here, you would then have some isolation if you are using an Ethernet transformer. So we have a second transformer here, basically drawn like this, and this is our ETH transformer, okay? So this Ethernet transformer then allows the Ethernet signals to couple across over here to the secondary side ground where we have our digital processor, and it's going to maintain the galvanic isolation requirement that's present in the Ethernet standard. Now, we don't normally put a capacitor across here, and there are a couple of reasons for that. The first reason is that the return current from the Ethernet line is already self-referential, right? You're routing in differential pairs as part of that Ethernet cabling, and those differential pairs already contain the return current from the incoming signal. So because differential pairs are self-referencing, basically one trace forms the ground reference for the other trace, it already contains the return current within a tight low inductance loop. That could eliminate the need for a capacitor here. However, I still think it's a good practice to at least just put a capacitor footprint across this barrier if you're using this Ethernet transformer. And of course, by putting this capacitor across this barrier and then DNIing it in your assembly, you can then place the capacitor here during testing to see if it has any effect on EMI. If you're having a problem with EMI, it might be solved by simply placing this capacitor. Having this capacitor footprint here but leaving it unpopulated gives you the freedom to experiment with capacitor placement and the size of the capacitor in order to help you control EMI if it happens to be a problem from this part of the design. Now, in this case, this would typically be a chassis ground. So you would basically have this going to a chassis ground connected to your enclosure, or it could be an earth ground. Depends on whether this device is going to plug into the wall or if it's going to be operating on battery. But now let's make one more assumption here. Let's just assume that we actually don't have a DC-DC converter, and there is no transformer here, and we don't have this Y-type capacitor right here. What then is this ground? Well, this could be your PGND region here for your Ethernet. So this could actually be your PGND region. And if this is your PGND region, you then need to ask, do I need to have a Y-type capacitor here? Well, you could leave this unpopulated, just as in the previous case, and you could then put a capacitor here if you're having an issue with EMI or while you're doing any EMI testing. Placing this capacitor here on an as-needed basis allows you to address an EMI problem if it exists. And if you don't need the capacitor and the device works as designed, then that's great. If you are going to place this capacitor here, make sure that it is a Y-type capacitor. Also, make sure that it has the correct voltage rating. You want to make sure that it can withstand at least 2.1 kilovolts of voltage, so that way it can be compliant with the Ethernet standard. So it's great to look at all this kind of stuff on the whiteboard, and I think it gives you some insight into how exactly the Y-type capacitor would normally be used, which is with a DC-DC converter. So let's look at two design examples in Altium Designer. One of these design examples is going to be something that's closer to your signal isolator component usage, and the other design example is specifically an isolated DC-DC converter. Let's go ahead and jump into Altium Designer and check it out. So what I want to do now is look at two examples inside Altium Designer, and what we're going to look at are example projects that I've shown on the Altium Academy channel. If you want to go watch the videos for these example projects or download the source file, just check out the link in the description. So here, the first design we're going to look at is our flyback converter module, and here in this flyback converter module, of course, we are using a transformer, as you can see here in 3D. Now, this
This transformer, of course, ensures that this must be an isolated system. And so, of course, we have two different ground nets that we have to deal with in this design. We have a primary ground and we have a secondary ground. Now here you can see I've placed a capacitor across our two ground nets. One is on our output ground side, which is just labeled GND. And then the other side is our power ground side, labeled PGND. Now this type of design would reflect the power converter stage as I mentioned on the whiteboard. In this example, what I've done is I've placed a cutout at the suggestion of a viewer in order to increase the creepage across this isolation barrier. And then we've placed the two grounds on each side of the transformer separately rather than overlapping them in the PCB layout. Now I could overlap the planes in this PCB layout, but the lower impedance path is through this transformer that bridges the primary side and the secondary side. As you can see here, this capacitor is a 2.2 nanofarad capacitor, so it's not huge, but it does provide the isolation barrier that we need at 300 volts AC. Now, if you're working in some systems, you could see a much higher voltage rating used on these safety capacitors. For example, you can get all the way up to several kilovolts isolation rating on these capacitors if that's what you need in your particular system. The other reason we would do it this way in this type of system is, of course, because how the transformer pins line up. You can see here that the transformer pins line up on each side of this design in a line. And so, of course, it doesn't make sense to extend the secondary side ground over to the primary side ground when all of the pins for the secondary side ground are located on one side of the transformer package. And finally, what is the function of the Y-type capacitor? Well, the function of the Y-type capacitor is very simple. The Y-type capacitor is meant to allow high-frequency noise currents on the secondary side to flow back over to the primary side and eventually back over to the power input over here. This allows those noise currents to complete a circuit by flowing back to the primary side of the design rather than generating radiated emissions from the secondary side ground plane. The next example that I want to look at is our dual ADC module example, as you can see here on screen. Now, this type of design more closely reflects your signal isolator portion of the design, and it somewhat reflects the Ethernet transformer section of the design. But in any case, this design uses separate grounds, and if we just go to the copper layers, you can see how these separate grounds are set up. Now, the reason we have separate grounds in this ADC design is because this design uses an isolated ADC. So there are galvanically isolated ADCs that are basically used to take low SNR or moderate SNR measurements in an environment where there could be exposure to high voltage. So this basically provides a level of safety through some galvanic isolation. Now here on the secondary side, you can see how we've set up these grounds. Here we have an analog ground on the left side, which then connects to our isolated ADC, that's U3 right here on the board. And then we have our main ground over here. You can see it's labeled GND. So as we just scroll through the different copper layers, you can basically see how the grounding is set up for the analog portion, or the AGND ground net. It's totally separated with its own isolation barrier, and there's no overlap between any of the plane layers in this design. By enforcing this type of separation, rather than having the AGND and GND nets overlapping each other on different layers, we've basically eliminated any parasitic capacitance that could allow a high frequency noise to couple into this signal line that you see here coming off of this SMA connector. This type of separation ensures that this Texas Instruments ADC here can take an accurate measurement of this low-level signal coming off of this SMA connector in the AGND region. In addition to galvanically isolating this signal, this separation also ensures that the digital interface on our non-isolated ADC doesn't conduct any noise into this sensitive ADC line. Now, as you can see here on screen, I have a lot of space in between this standard ADC and this isolated ADC. So of course, we're already at really low risk of noise coupling from this digital section into this analog line. So I think that's something important to consider. However, if you did happen to have these two components clustered very close together, using that isolated ADC provides both safety in terms of galvanic isolation, and it prevents noise coupling into that analog line on this isolated side. Now, the grounding that I've set up here in this analog ground region, where we have a physical separation between all these sections of copper, that's basically how you should do the PCB layout for your Ethernet transformer in your design. An even better option than using an Ethernet transformer is just to use a MagJack RJ45 connector. That MagJack RJ45 connector is inherently isolated, and you can maintain the galvanic isolation that you need by then leaving it disconnected from the chassis, although if you do have a problem with high frequency radiation, you could then create a chassis ring and make a direct connection to a chassis ring off of that RJ45 connector.
Thanks for watching this video, everybody. I hope this gives you the guidance you need to work with isolated grounds in a galvanically isolated system. Make sure to hit the subscribe button to keep up with all of my videos. Of course, make sure to go and subscribe to Altium Academy for more great PCB design content, and check out the links in the description for links to the projects that I showed in this video. I'll see you next time, everybody.